Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Welfare Reform Committee for 2015. Could everyone please make sure that mobile phones are either switched off or are on airplane mode? Before I come to our first agenda item, just to point out that Joan McAlpine has submitted her apologies for this morning's meeting. Our first item of business is our second oral evidence session on our women and welfare, or should I say women and social security inquiry. I think we will change it officially after the discussion we had at the last meeting. But today we're using a round table format for our discussions. This is an approach that we've used before on the committee. I think the members think it works quite well. It allows us to benefit from an ability to keep the discussion fluid, and it's a bit less stilted than a straightforward question and answer format. So all I would ask is that if you want to ask a question or make a contribution, just indicate to me, talk through me, don't talk over one another, and we'll try and keep the thing moving as quickly as possible and get as much information as we can in the time that's available to us. For the roundtable discussion this morning, I'm delighted to welcome Hanna, Ritchie, Allan, who's a project manager for Close the Gap; Jill Wood, policy manager at Engender; Bill Scott, director of policy at Inclusion Scotland; Belinda Phipps, CEO of the Fawcett Society; Nina Murray, Women's Policy Development Officer at Scottish Refugee Council; Angela O'Hagan, Convener of Scottish Women's Budget Group; Suzanne Conlin, Board of Directors, Scottish Women's Convention; Anne Henderson, Assistant Secretary at the STUC; and Joe Ozga, who's a policy worker at Scottish Women's Aid. So welcome to you all. I hope you do feel that we get some benefit from the discussion this morning. In order to kick things off, I'm going to come straight to Jill Wood and ask her just a question to get us into the discussion. Thanks very much to everyone for submissions, and thanks particularly, Jill, for yours, because 22 recommendations at the end of it, it's always useful to get some very clear and distinct suggestions as to what we can do. But it comes on the back of your submission, and just before you get to the conclusions and recommendations, you say in that a targeted policy response that aims to redress this gender discrimination and is aligned with Scottish Government action to tackle the drivers of women's inequality is sorely needed. So 22 recommendations to address a sorely needed gap to be closed. What would the priorities amongst that 22 be? Just where would we have to start to get some progress being made?
Well, the recommendations are split over existing Scottish Government policy and powers we already have over social security issues, and then those that are to come with the devolution of further powers. And at the moment, the first recommendation that we make, and I should say off the bat that this was a joint report that was written with Close the Gap, Scottish Women's Aid, Scottish Refugee Council and the SCBO, most of whom are here today as well. But the first recommendation that we make is that the Scottish Government should develop a specific concrete action plan to tackle the impact of welfare reform on women, which we know a lot about now. And that needs to be joined up with other areas that relate to gender equality and devolve policy areas that relate to gender equality. Because primarily for us, this is a gender equality issue, obviously, in terms of the extremely disproportionate impact on women. And the House of Commons library analysis puts that at 85% of all related cuts. But also in terms of the reasons for that figure in the first place. So the structural reasons that drive the fact that women are twice as dependent on social security as men are, and the fact that unpaid women carers are twice as likely to give up paid work in order to care. So if we want to do something different and gender the approach, then our response has to take stock of those dynamics about women's caring responsibilities, about the pay gap, and really link it to policy areas here, such as employability, social care, childcare, and so on. Because I think we're all aware that often government responses can exist in their own areas. And also, this fits quite neatly with current Scottish Government commitments to prioritise gender equality at the moment. And so this agenda, it works both ways. It needs to be gendered to have a more positive impact on women, and to prevent further harm from them through these policies. But also the fact that this, if it isn't gendered, then it stands to, the agenda stands to undermine other areas of government work. And in fact, it can support that ambition to be better on gender, essentially.
Yeah.
But that first recommendation about developing a specific plan, because if the response isn't targeted towards women, then a blanket approach. A lot of the work that the Scottish Government has done definitely has had a positive impact on women, but it hasn't targeted them particularly. And a lot of colleagues here are representing particular groups of women, and that's another key point to make right from the start, that obviously women aren't one homogenous group of people, but lots of different groups, refugee women, disabled women, need to have targeted responses as well.
Yeah, and that was going to bring me on to my second point, if I come to Bill Scott. I mean, multiple impacts. Bill, do you want to give us an idea from Inclusion Scotland's perspective of the disability communities, just what this added impacts are?
Yeah, I mean, part of the problem is that so many of the cuts have been targeted at disabled people and their benefits, but disabled women are also impacted because they're carers, because they're lone parents, because they're black, because of their sexuality, etc. All of these factors as well. You know, disabled women, it's not just two factors. There's many factors to their lives. And, you know, cuts to child benefit, for example, are one of the biggest cuts that have hit disabled women. So it's not a cut targeted at people who are disabled, but it is a cut which impacts disproportionately on them because, again, like women in general, they rely for far more of their income on benefits because they're less likely to be in work and less likely to be the only recipient of benefits in the household. But they're more likely to manage the budget in the household, so it falls again on them to cope with the cuts that are falling on the household, whether it's, you know, a cut to child benefit or a cut to their partner's benefits. They're the one that's put in the position of coming up with the rent, coming up with the food to put on the table, etc. And we know from many, many studies in the past that the purse holder is often the target of domestic abuse because they're held responsible for not being able to pay the rent, put the food on the table, etc. So there's many, many impacts. And certainly for disabled women, you know, the multiple impact is even disproportionately greater in terms of the sheer scale of the income loss to those households.
Okay. Belinda, you wanted to come? I'll come to you, Karen.
From the Fawcett Society, and obviously our interest is in women overall, although individual groups of women suffer different levels of disadvantage. I think our big issue is that the benefit system, full stop, has been designed with a one-size-fits-all eye, and actually often with a male eye, with presumptions about the way that the world works, and if fundamentally what needs to happen is the system needs to be designed through a female lens and checked through a male lens, but designed through a female lens. We know that women's lives, because of the way that they're brought up, the gender differentiated way that women are treated, it means that women are much more likely to be poor. So women, for example, make up two-thirds of the low paid. There is a pay gap which increases women's poverty. Women are much more likely to have caring responsibilities. They're presumed to be, and quite often are, the primary carer of children. Yet the welfare system doesn't take that into account when it thinks about benefits. And the Fawcett Society has recently conducted an investigation into job seekers' allowance, which is, the intention is to get people back into work in the belief that working will alleviate poverty. And when you look at that through a female eye, you can see that the job seekers' allowance creates all sorts of problems for women. If a woman is a primary carer, then particularly if she's a lone parent, as over 90% of lone parents are women, she is at a very high risk of being sanctioned for failing to come to an appointment on time. And if you talk to the women, and we've heard many dreadful stories of women who fully wanted to be at their appointment but couldn't get there, no bus, it snowed, a small child, you know, had a hissy fit, needed to go to the lavatory, childcare arrangements broke down at the last minute, and there appears to be an application of sanctions without understanding of the lived experience of women who are by and large poorer and the primary carers of children. So fundamentally, if Scotland were able to do it, a redesign of the system taking a female point of view would be very helpful, until we can get to the stage where our young boys and girls are brought up without this gender differentiation that pushes women into low-paid, lowly valued work, and it virtually being the exclusive carers, and boys away from doing any of the domestic support work. Until we change that, we have to design our system through a gendered lens.
Anne, do you want to jump in at this point?
From the STUC's point of view, sorry, it would be quite interested to draw out the contrast between the very inflexible nature of the benefit system and the fact, as you were referring to the previous meeting, it doesn't actually provide security. The sort of contrast between the labour market, which is in our discussions about what would be a good workplace, a fair workplace, the discussions with the Scottish Government around the Fair Work Convention, there are some real opportunities for looking at how we design jobs and workplace interventions and support for people in work in a better way, in a way that reflects their life cycle and the changes that take place in their lives, and some of the points that Belinda mentioned there. But it's running in contrast in Scotland, I think, that kind of approach, which we are very keen to support, with the way that the benefit system operates, which is sanctions driven and punitive, and doesn't deal with the realities of, in this case, women's lives. So I think there's quite a contradiction developing, which in terms of how it fits with other parts of Scottish Government's policy and other things that we can do in Scotland, we really need to try and explore, and I hope we'll get into a wee bit of discussion about that today, because we are promoting flexible working practices, for instance, to try to assist parents and in this case women staying in the labour market, yet the sanctions that apply if you miss an appointment while seeking work, or, you know, just completely contradictory. So hopefully we can get into a bit of discussion about that today.
Okay, Anna, okay.
Yeah, I think one thing that we would like to point out is that specifically in relation to employability and job-seeking support services, which, as Anne had mentioned, as we look at women's participation in the labour market, women continue to have a very different experience to men. And generic employability programmes will only serve to replicate existing gendered patterns of skills acquisition and employment. So, and what that means is, because also Belinda and Anne mentioned the gender pay gap, of course, which has an impact on women's pay, so therefore impacts on poverty and children's poverty as well. So the pay gap affects women throughout their lifetimes, and it impacts also on their income in retirement. So until we address the causes of the pay gap, flexible working, or lack of flexible working, as Anne mentioned, and specifically in the context of employability programmes, occupational segregation, where women are clustered into low-paid, undervalued jobs, until employability programmes address occupational segregation, until they take cognizance of the gendered barriers to employment, then that's only serving to further entrench occupational segregation and widen the gender pay gap.
Okay. Angela, you wanted to chip in?
Thank you, Convener. And thank you for the reframing of the debate in terms of social security, because ultimately that's what we're talking about as well, is this protection and recognition of transition and life circumstances that colleagues have so clearly set out. I think to pick up on some of the points, in the Scottish Women's Budget Group submission, we put biggest emphasis in some ways on the cross-portfolio and cross-disciplinary analysis that's needed from the committee and from Scottish Government. And central to that, I think, are the budget and spending plans and how revenue is raised in Scotland, and the economic strategy. And the economic strategy starts, you know, is where colleagues have started to take some of this debate as well. And I think in terms of the next steps for this committee, while the inquiry is very necessary and very welcome, the next steps I think are as important. And so when it comes to the scrutiny of public spending, the scrutiny of public authorities, and the extent to which there is a robust gender analysis, and I think there needs to be time and investment in improving gender analysis and gender awareness across public authorities, because we see decisions repeatedly made in a way that completely ignores the conditions and circumstances that colleagues around the table have alluded to. So that improvement inequality impact assessment and that understanding of what constitutes gender awareness and therefore the impact on women and men, and that so many of the measures we're seeing are so, you know, gendered along the lines that Belinda and others have talked about. And that has an effect on women, and it also has an effect on that whole recasting of gender relations, you know, that transformative shift that we're trying to see. And as Anne has said, there's that we have this contrast between what we're trying to do, you know, where we are in Scotland in some of the discourse, you know, some of what's talked about, and some of the practical and policy realities. So within the Scotland's economic strategy, when it talks about investment in infrastructure, we want to see the committee scrutinise, and we want to see what the Scottish Government means by that investment in infrastructure. Does that include the care infrastructure that would support women and men's roles as carers, as workers, and as parents? And is that the kind of economic growth we're talking about that recognises the care economy, recognises the transitions of people's lives and the need for a social security system that isn't so gender biased and so rigid in its administrations, in the administration of it, that it completely ignores the lived reality of people's lives, where sanctions, as Belinda and others have said, cut right across the daily realities. So we need to see that policy read across in social security, in the further powers that are being devolved, what energy, in a sense, is being put in at this end in Scotland to remove some of those administrative barriers to making the system, in the first instance, more humane, but also to craft a different approach to social security and social investment and protection in Scotland.
Kevin, you want to go?
Thank you, Convener. One of the things which we have found over the course of our deliberations is that the vast bulk of folk who come here, no matter their ability or disability, actually want to be in employment. And a lot of them have barriers into getting into employment because, as Angela has just said, the system is far too rigid. I want to paint a wee picture, Convener. Somebody who has a disabled child, who's in receipt of carer's allowance, who would have childcare difficulties if they worked out with school time, told that if they earn over £110, they lose everything, desperate to work. Employers have flexibility to allow that to happen, but, you know, it's still all very difficult. And in terms of being able to break even, if they lose the benefit, they have to earn £27,000 a year. Now, somebody desperate to work, a system which really is impeding that. Do you think that here in Scotland we should have the ability to get rid of that rigidity, to apply common sense and actually help those folk back who want to go into work, back into work, and ensure that they don't lose anything because they want to go back into work?
Does anyone want to pick that up, Bill?
Yeah, I think we did an analysis of the work programme last year because I was speaking at an employability conference, and I worked out that since the work programme started, a disabled person on it is four times as likely to be sanctioned as actually to be placed in what is called a positive outcome. In other words, work of any lengthy period whatsoever. So you've got a system that is punishing people rather than supporting them into work. And everything that disabled people said about the work programme from the outset is coming true. It cherry picks. It works with those closest to the labour market, you know, when they're referred, to get them into work because they're easier to get into work. And those that have either never been in work or are, you know, far from the labour market because they've got acquired impairments or because they're a woman, whatever, are not given the tailored support that they actually need. And again, there's a lot of time spent on pushing people towards work who cannot work, which is a waste of resources, rather than helping those who genuinely want to move into work and are capable of part-time work, probably with support, but are maybe not capable of a full-time job because of the nature of the impairments. Somebody with MS or ME, for example, would be much more interested in part-time work because fatigue is a huge factor in their lives. You know, they're often not able to work a full day. And they cannot get that sort of support from the system as it exists because it only recognises that full-time work is valuable. And again, it punishes. With universal credit, it will begin to punish people who do not take additional steps to move from part-time work to full-time work. So we do need to redesign the system. The case I would make is that, you know, the people that know best about how the system affects their lives are the women, disabled women included, who are in that system, and they can make the recommendations. And that's one of the things we would urge the committee to do, is actually urge Scottish Government to work with people to genuinely co-produce the future benefit system in Scotland so that it actually does take into account all the needs, particularly childcare needs. And again, parents of disabled children face additional barriers on top of the normal childcare barriers to get the sort of childcare that actually fits the needs of their child who may not be able to go into just a conventional childcare setting.
If it were possible for Scotland to redesign the system, I think that would be the optimum solution, because we do need to think more broadly about where we want to go for the future. And if I had a magic wand and could give it to the Scottish Parliament, it would be fantastic if we could have a system that enabled people, both men and women, to earn a living wage working 4 days a week rather than five. So everybody worked, the working week became 4 days a week, because what that would do is simultaneously allow the benefits of the unpaid work that society needs in terms of caring for children, caring for other people and all the community activity to take place. If we had a magic wand, that would work for women, but I think it would also work for men. The alternative is to make less bad the system that we've already got. And it is unfortunately rigid and complicated and has not been designed through a female eye. So that is by far the messier and more difficult situation. So I would urge that Scotland thinks about integrating what it does in the way of benefits or social security with what it does in the way of supporting people into work, and does it in recognition that people have lives outside work which involve unpaid work that society needs just as much as the paid work there is.
I was looking at the report that was published yesterday, which some of the organisations here were involved in, from Napier University, that was commissioned by the Scottish Government, and there's some about tracking welfare reform, and there's some very powerful testimonies in there which overlap with our concerns around women accessing the labour market, including, for example, a real powerful description of the difficulty of getting ready to go to work or to attend a compulsory job interview, having been up all night dealing with and supporting a child with a disability in the home. And I think that I'm sure that the committee will look at that report, but there's something in there that we can't wait to try to sort out. So whilst there are and the STUC would support the devolution of further powers in this regard. There's also some steps that we need to find a way as a society in Scotland of addressing right now that recognises those pressures and those lives that women are living. I think to come back to the evidence that was taken at the previous meeting around the value of unpaid work, you know, that kind of, in a way, that sort of some, that wee case study sort of sums some of that up. And if there's some other way that allowances can be devised or support can be given to that type of family situation that doesn't necessarily wait until we have additional powers, then I think we need to look at these things. The second thing I just wanted to pick up on is around the living wage, and that's something that the Fair Work Convention has, you know, made a commitment to promoting and extending the living wage. I think that obviously we would be supportive of that. However, would be concerned that it's become a kind of shorthand for an aspiration, which, to be honest, is not adequate in our view. So if you match up what we would say was the value of care, the value of both childcare, care for the elderly, the skills that are involved in giving really good quality care for everybody in our communities, then the living wage isn't high enough. It's not enough, to be honest. And I think it kind of links into the problems around segregation and occupational segregation. I want to see a campaign that says care workers are worth a considerably larger amount. And I think that the independent review that's just been published on the childcare workforce and out-of-school care workforce gives us an opportunity to have a bit of that discussion as well around what are our national standards that we expect for payment around care. And then that comes back to, it's not enough just to keep saying we really value the unpaid care. Well, actually, we need to begin to put some figures on that. And there are examples, I don't have the statistics here, but I know the Scottish Government has done some of this, where in a two-wage household, where both workers are on the living wage, the income actually drops because of the knock-on effect on working tax credit and child tax credit. So we really need to look at the interrelationship between some of the headlines and what's actually happening in terms of household income, not just individual income.
Come back briefly to points made about employment and support and the lack of flexibility and further powers. Specifically, one other thing we mentioned in our report and recommendations is through whatever avenues this committee might have to push for as much flexibility as possible for the clause in the Scotland Bill that sets out powers over employment support. So as that goes through Parliament, that's something that we'll be looking at.
Yep. Does anyone start? Nina.
Thanks. Just to come in on some more examples of the inflexibility of the system and following up from what Jill was saying there about employment support, we're working with predominantly newly granted refugee women and also women arriving in the country through refugee family reunion, and there are many multiple barriers that those women face that are similar to some of those that have been discussed already, and additionally barriers that come from their prior experience before arriving in Scotland, experiences of trauma, health issues and persecution, but there are particular issues within the welfare system. So those women are coming into the system already at a disadvantage, not knowing very much about the system. It's a very complex system, and they're facing, from our evidence shows that they're facing financial hardship and also issues around dependency, and there are particular impacts on these groups of women around the system itself and how it's inflexible to their needs. For example, we're finding that of our clients who are being sanctioned, around over 90% of those are being sanctioned in the first 6 months of being on welfare support in Scotland. So that suggests that there's issues around their understanding of the system, around their English language. We know for our client group, almost two-thirds of them have very basic levels of English. So there certainly implies some issues there around the complexity of the system and how that's affecting them and how they're being punished for that rather than supported through that at that early stage. We've got examples of the Refugee Women's Strategy Group that we work with have been working with some Scottish Government funding to develop a tailored employment support programme for refugee women, and they've been feeding, they developed the system themselves with the Glasgow ESOL Forum they developed the programme, sorry, with the Glasgow ESOL Forum and then participated in it, and it was evaluated, and it found, developed a model of very targeted employment support that really worked for them, and it wasn't about being put onto a general work programme that didn't meet their specific needs. It was about them saying, this is what we need to help us into employment. And like others have said, they really wanted to be in employment, but there were needs there that weren't being met around English language, around IT literacy, around the timing and childcare available to participate in those programmes. And I think you know, Scotland could really do something if it had the powers to design more tailored employment support to meet the needs of those different groups of women. I think that would be really beneficial.
Yeah, that's interesting, your comments on women refugees who've been sanctioned within 6 months, because we've had communications with UK ministers and they insist that the sanctions regime is an issue of last resort. It's hard to imagine that someone's got into a position of last resort within 6 months of arriving in the country, but that's just another evidence of the contradiction between the position of the government and the reality on the ground. Joe, you wanted to...
I think just to reiterate some of what Nina was saying and others have said about employability support, for women who have experienced domestic abuse, they find it really difficult to get back into work when they feel able to do so. There's very little support for them in relation to building their self-esteem and their confidence and understanding the impact that abuse has had on them. You know, 2% of women, according to EHRC research, lose their jobs as a result of domestic abuse. And often then struggle going through applications for employment support allowance, which doesn't recognise the impact of domestic abuse on their physical and mental health, and also then going through job seekers allowance, conditionality requirements, and being sanctioned as a result of not being able to cope with them. So we would certainly be making a plea for employability support programmes that can offer specialised support to women in that situation.
Before I come to Margaret McDougall, I wanted to offer Suzanne the opportunity to come in at this point.
I suppose to add, we've found a lot of what's been said today. Women are telling us primarily about the system being very punitive. It's not supporting them back into work. A lot of women are finding that the system is keeping them out of employment. It's keeping them back. They are, because a lot of the thresholds, particularly with tax credits, it stops them going for promotions. It stops them going for access to employment. And therefore they feel they're stuck in poverty, and instead the system supporting them out of it, it's keeping them there. And one of the things we're looking for is more support to get women back into employment, education, skills. In particular, we find the impact is even worse on rural women. Rural women are finding that it's so much harder for them because they don't have a lot of stuff on their doorstep. A lot was said about transport, childcare, all these things make it so much harder for women who live in rural communities to even get to job interviews on time.
Margaret, you wanted to come in?
Yes, thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. Just on the sanctions, I note in the submission from Inclusion Scotland, they're saying that sanctions for lone parents on JISA have risen from under £200 per month prior to 2008 to £4,700 per month now, which is absolutely shocking. And yet we still have ministers who are in denial around this. It's just unbelievable. My question was on job seekers allowance and just how people are dealt with when they go along to the job centres, particularly people with mental health issues, because that's something that is very often overlooked. And I just wonder, has anyone seen any evidence that mental health is actually taken into account? Do people who are working in these offices have any skills to recognise where people actually have mental health issues? And just I'd welcome comments.
Before I come to you, Bill, I think Claire, you've got a similar point, is it?
No, I'll come in after.
Okay, right. Bill, come in there.
The evidence is, if it's taken into account, it's taken into account in a very negative way. Of the disabled people who are being sanctioned, 60% of those who are sanctioned have either mental health issues or learning difficulties or both. We're coming back to the same problem as with refugee women etc., that they may have an incomplete understanding of the conditions that are applied to them. They may agree to conditions that are completely unrealistic for them, you know, 30 job applications a week when it would take them hours to complete a single one. Takes me hours to complete a single job application, far less somebody with learning difficulties. So it's all those sort of things, and whether that's targeting or not, it's certainly a complete, you know, disregard for the barriers that they face in meeting the conditions for the receipt benefit. So yeah, you know, women with mental health issues are being disproportionately affected by the sanctions regime.
Suzanne?
Women are telling us the same thing, that often when they go for assessments, it's all based on physical issues and there's no real understanding of mental health and what's happened to them, and the push is for full-time work, when often women with mental health issues, maybe part-time work is maybe more suitable to them to kind of support them back in the workplace. So yeah, we're finding a lot of issues.
Can I make one more point on this? It's a really important one. We've just published a research report which very much echoes the Scottish Government's tracking study, and one of the huge concerns I have is that women who were victims of sexual abuse in the assessment system, and it very much echoes what's just been said, were having to relive the trauma of their abuse because they were meeting a male assessor for the first time and being asked to recount the details of why they had post-traumatic stress syndrome. Now, it's a completely different experience for a woman having to say that, even to her GP, who she may have known for years and years and years, to disclose that. But to be forced to disclose it in an interview with somebody you've never met, you know, and go over the details of it and how it's affected your mental health, I think it's appalling. And you know, we have to, in the old paper system that existed for disability living allowance, that wouldn't have happened. Women would have been able to disclose, she would have got medical evidence to support her claim, and that would have been it. The award would have been made. Now, the concentration is on the physical effects rather than the mental health effects. And one woman was actually visited at home on a Saturday night by a male assessor who spent 15 minutes hammering at her door. She phoned the police. And then he left a note and left and said that he would come back on the Tuesday. And rather than face that, she dropped her claim. So, you know, these are the sort of issues. And, you know, if we're going to design a more humane system, we have to take into account, you know, these mental health issues that affect people, and really tailor the system to deal with them rather than force them to go through an assessment that is usually unnecessary to get benefits they need to live on.
Jill?
To quickly mention another specifically gendered element, which Bill, you brought up at our last event, about the fact that women have to, in order to be eligible for ESA on grounds of mental health, are having to provide different forms of proof that they're eligible for it because they're women. So they have to, I think Bill, you might know more about it, they have to provide two forms of...
A woman at risk of self-harm or suicide has to have more wrong with her than a man in the same position. It has to provide... When they apply for ESA and they go to the assessment, the actual assessor's instructions, the regulations, you know, the guidance that they're bound by, tells them that there has to be a higher level of risk for the woman than for a man. So to get the Employment Support Allowance, a woman has to be in greater danger of suicide than a man. And I just find that, again, it's pure and outright discrimination, and I'm sure it's challengeable, but you know, somebody has to take a case before you know, those regulations will be struck down.
I think, having heard that, one specific we'll take out of this morning is I'll write to the UK government and ask specifically to explain why that's the situation, because that's an appalling set of circumstances. Belinda.
Some specific examples might be helpful, because if you're female, the system doesn't work for you, but if you have anything else at all, whether you can't speak English very well, whether you're disabled, whether you have mental health problems, whether you're a lone parent, there are some issues. So here's an example that was sent to me this morning. A few years ago, my husband was made redundant. We had to claim job seekers. I had a baby, and there was a foot of snow outside. Post delivery and buses were cancelled, and I live in a rural area up a hill where nobody on our village road was able to get out that day. I phoned them to let them know I couldn't get into town with my baby to sign on that week, but I would come as soon as I could, perhaps the following day. I called first thing that morning. They sanctioned my payment that week. I put in a challenge to get it reassessed. I didn't eat properly that week while still breastfeeding. I was so stressed. We coped. And then when I was to launch my own business, I applied for a small startup grant and I was refused because there had been a sanction. It was such a humiliating experience. It's well known that shame is a trauma, and yet they do this to people. I don't think it's about saving money at all. It's an ideologically driven exercise which enslaves. And then a caller to a gingerbread helpline, a single parent, had a five-year-old child and is being pressured by her work programme to look for full-time jobs, and her provider didn't explain about the parent flexibilities. They exist, but they're not being explained to people who might get them. A caller was required to attend 2-3-hour sessions during the summer holidays. She was told not to bring her children, but there was no suitable childcare available. Another caller was told to pay for childcare himself during the summer holidays while on a work programme. He also was told he had to look for full-time work when his child turns 11. That's a lone parent, and that's not correct. And in the report, there are examples after examples of the unfair system being applied in a punitive way, or the easements and flexibility in the system not being communicated or allowed to the person. And then when the person is sanctioned, the ability to appeal not being communicated clearly to the person. So people are in a no-win situation. And there are individual people with individual stories that the inquiry listened to over and over again, which are heartbreaking. And those people that are articulate and more able to handle it fully acknowledge, they say, I was able to get this to happen. I was able to get my sanction overturned because I'm reasonably well educated. But Lord knows how anybody who is depressed or disabled or can't speak English does it. And those are the people that cannot speak up for themselves. They have no money.
Okay. I'll come to Anne and then Angela.
I just wanted to pick up on a couple of things. I've got a couple of reports that I'll pass on to the committee from different trade unions. The STUC obviously has a number of different affiliated trade unions, and the Shop Workers Union, mainly with workers in the retail sector, produced a report looking at the impact of some of the changes over the last few years under the previous UK government. Mm-hmm. And one of the points they pick up there is the recurring, the numbers of women who don't return to work after they've had a baby, and the drop off there. And I think that there is an issue in there, both in terms of what workplace conditions have been negotiated for women to return to work, but also around the crossover with, I mean, real concerns about poverty then as a consequence, because of the capping and freezing around benefits may impact on maternity benefit as well, but also around what I wanted to flag up was around postnatal depression and a number of the conditions associated with mental health following the birth of a child, for which the system and employers in general are really, really inadequately prepared to support and deal with. And I do think that sometimes women don't return to work, not because that's really the best choice, but because there's not been the supports in the system to phase a return, to mentor them when they go back to work or whatever. And there are a whole number of things that, again, we could do together as employers and trade union reps. The second point I wanted to pick up on is some interesting work that Unite the Union has been doing around the mental health of the reps, trade union reps in the workplace. And I think there is an emerging real issue there as well. For us, in terms of collectively trying to best support people in staying in work, or taking doing what's best for them at a particular time in their life, but returning to the labour market. The role of trade union reps is very important, and the anecdotal evidence and now some of the case studies is showing, as Unite have demonstrated, that they really, the mental health of their own reps is really deteriorating. People are having to deal with horrendous case studies, really difficult situations. Many trade union reps are not, many advice workers are not experts in the complexities of the benefit system, the in-work allowances and the way everything overlaps with each other. It's difficult to get the appropriate signposting, and the effort and trauma and pressure that is being experienced by trade union reps is also becoming an issue. And I think, again, in terms of the Scotland that we want to be part of and the context set by our aspirations to work closely with trade unions, to work with employers and respect that collective bargaining can really be an asset working with HR and working in a workplace, then we need to look at that. So facility time is important, the support for reps is important, and we should see that as an investment in helping people manage and negotiate what is a very difficult economic situation at present. So I can pass on some of these reports to the committee.
That's great. I'll come to Angela and then come back to the Deputy Convener before we move too far away from the point she wanted to make, Angela.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to link some of these points together to I think, make the point really that what we're talking about is systemic failure. The systemic failure to prioritise equality and to prioritise dignity and decency, despite the legislative requirements to do that through the public sector equality duties, through the Social Work Act and the duty on public authorities to ensure social welfare, through commitments to end child poverty and so on. And I think what we're seeing is the cumulative effect on women's lives, the chaos that is being wreaked on people's lives by these reforms to welfare that are politically motivated to drive people out the system and to reduce welfare spend as a deficit reduction measure with no regard for the cost to people's lives and subsequently the cost to public services. And that triple jeopardy that the Fawcett Society identified of the cumulative impact of the loss of women's jobs, the impact of cuts, public spending cuts on women's lives and the withdrawal of public services. And those political choices that at the UK level that have seen by Professor Diane Elson's reckoning, and I know Diane was here with the committee last week, the political choice to remedy previous spending decisions, previous political decisions, by taking 82% of public spending cuts as opposed to 18% in income in tax revenue. They are politically motivated choices, and I think choices that we need to lay bare. And consistent with that is the impact of the council tax freeze in Scotland and elsewhere in the UK, differently rolled out and differently mitigated in different places. But nonetheless, that's having an effect on the poorest amongst us and poor people's lives, their access to services, and compounding again the cumulative effect of this systemic failure to recognise the differential impact within cuts to the benefits system, as poor people rely most on public services that are being withdrawn. And according to colleagues from the Poverty Alliance and Child Poverty Action Group, the council tax freeze isn't actually reaching those with the lowest incomes. So again, that cumulative effect being compounded. And I think in terms of actions, again, I would take the committee back to the budget and how are resources being allocated to mitigate and eliminate these excesses and the consequences of these political decisions. In Plan F, the Scottish Women's Budget Group and UK Women's Budget Group set out a series of ways in which some of these decisions could be rectified, and some of these are within the scope of the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government. Currently, and with the further powers that are being discussed, there is opportunity to reverse some of the cuts to public services. There is opportunity to address some of the administrative barriers that are causing the kind of chaos that we're hearing about. The equality pledge that the Scottish Government has made is a welcome step to putting business responsibility for workers' rights back in the frame, in a sense. So there are plenty of levers currently and more to come, but they have to be seen across the piece, I think, is the biggest sort of plea we would make through Plan F and through using how public resources are allocated and the scrutiny that is applied back to public authorities around the decision-making that they make. How do decisions like the one that Bill has just talked about in terms of the criteria for women to demonstrate the poor state of their mental health to be higher, those criteria to be set at a higher level than men. And the public health directors have come out against that. But that, again, needs to follow up. How did that systemic failure happen within a decision-making process that results in that effect on individuals?
Okay, thanks, Angela. I'll come to Claire for you to make the point you want to make.
Convener, it was really when we're talking about what has happened so far in terms of reform of the social security system, but we're neither in a static situation in terms of extra powers or in what's still to come. And I would like to tease out what the impact, I think the Fawcett Society and Close the Gap both mentioned, the effect of universal credit on lone parent families, and also I'm very concerned about the £3 billion cut to disability benefits still to come in the move from DLA to PIP. And I wonder if we could tease out just what that transition is doing and what you expect the problems to be.
I mean, we expect half of current recipients of the higher rate mobility component of DLA to lose it on the transfer to personal independence payment, because the new walking test is if you can walk 20 metres, whereas the DLA test was if you can walk 50 metres safely, repeatedly, etc. So, as you may have noticed, high-profile cases are already being reported. A Paralympian lost her mobility component when she was reassessed for the new benefit. And as I say, the DWP expect around 50% of current recipients of higher rate mobility to lose it. And that has a particular impact in Scotland, which is far more rural than the rest of the United Kingdom. We have people living a lot further from services, retail, etc. And the loss of the mobility component, and probably in about a third of the cases, their mobility vehicle, will mean that they just cannot reach services on their own, which is going to, you know, impose extra costs on them at a time when they've lost benefits. So, you know, there is definitely going to be a very severe impact. And one of the main problems is if there is a delay in the transfer of the benefits, we've already lost a large part of the budget that we might want to use in a different way when we get control of DLA, carers allowance, PIP, etc. If most of the people, the vast majority, have already been transferred across to the new benefit, then people are already lost, and I don't think that the Scottish Government is going to be able to raise sufficient funds to put that right again. Whereas, you know, if the transfer took place just now, we might be able to stop that loss to disabled people's income.
Kevin?
Convener, we took evidence just the other week from a woman who was in work, who had the high mobility DLA, who was very afraid that PIP would be withdrawn. I wonder if Inclusion Scotland or any other organisation have done any analysis into the net contribution to the public purse of folks who are in work, who currently receive that higher level of mobility, who may lose out. Because in that case, Convener, and I'm sure in many, many others, that woman was a net contributor.
There has been some work done by Disability Rights UK to investigate how many people, disabled people currently in work, are likely to lose entitlement to benefits that help them remain in work. Now, the problem is you can't say with absolute certainty that you lose your mobility component, you will also lose your job. But you know, it will probably be a contributory factor in some disabled people losing their jobs. And I think there have been estimates. I can look them out for you and send them on as to what the actual loss in terms of tax revenue is likely to be.
I think that would be extremely useful. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda.
Yeah, just to come back on Claire's point about lone parents, it's already been mentioned, of course, that the vast majority of lone parents are women, and what we know is that the new income support rules require single mothers to take part in work-focused interviews when their youngest child is one. And women with children as young as 3 or 4 can be required to undertake mandatory work activity. And recipients of Job Seekers Allowance can be referred to Job Centre Plus staff to complete unpaid work placements of 4 weeks of up to 30 hours a week. Now, obviously, the implications around childcare are quite obvious, are quite clear there, and those who don't comply face sanctions. What we know about childcare is that it's massively expensive, prohibitively so for a lot of people, so that is in some ways one of the most immediate barriers to women accessing the labour market or going back into the labour market after having children. So lone parents are particularly impacted in that respect. If they do manage to secure childcare, although provision in itself is patchy, particularly for women with disabled children or women living in rural areas, they're likely to have to take part-time work in order to balance their paid work with the childcare responsibilities. But part-time work is largely concentrated in low-paid, undervalued jobs. And what that means is that many women are working below their skill level, working below their potential, and that impacts on their pay, on their progression, on their income in retirement. But also that means that the women's skills are being underutilised. So the economic impact that has on local economies, but also on Scotland's economy as well.
Okay. Christina.
Very much, Convener. I want to sort of touch on a different point, but very, very well connected, and it's in relation to the benefits cap and whether there has been, you know, any of the groups here or representatives have done any analysis on the impact of the benefits cap, given that it's the talk is now to further reduce that. And all of the evidence that we've had thus far, if not absolutely pointedly, maybe a bit more subtly, has suggested that we should have some sort of a human rights-based approach to how we develop or fix a broken system. And I realised yesterday, there was a bit of news yesterday, that Lord Kerr in the Supreme Court has ordered a judicial review of the benefits cap and its impact on children. Now, given that 85% of all the welfare cuts impact on women, and the biggest majority of them will be the carers of those children, I'm looking to see if there's been any work or analysis or understanding to help us understand that. I know that when it was picked out very early in the benefits cap that for people suffering domestic violence who are in refugees, that was a huge impact, and they managed to change that quite quickly. Whether there's been any, you know, campaign and work or anything done to understand that, and whether, you know, on top of all of that, if a withdrawal from the ECHR and the Human Rights Act then take away all of that ability for people to have, you know, those challenges that Bill spoke about, and for Lord Kerr to make his recommendation that it should be judicially reviewed because, in the rights of the child, it did not give adequate food, shelter, clothing, warmth, or the basic necessities of life. And that's a fundamental part of all of this. You know, we're talking about bits of the system that matter greatly, but the overall system, you know, and the ability to challenge that, you know, when you've got the ability to challenge it, or you've got somebody to advocate on your behalf, is very detrimentally impacted upon. So I know that's a bit, quite a lot of stuff in there, you know, but it seemed to tie up lots of points that people have made around the table this morning. We do have the Scottish National Action Plan on Human Rights, and, you know, how maybe we can work with that, if, you know, we could have some sort of a devolution of human rights to ensure that we have a system that has a human rights approach.
I don't know of any work yet, but I'm sure people will be beavering away on it. But we do know that NetMums did a survey of 2,000 mothers, and they discovered that 1 in 5 mothers are going without meals in order that their children might eat. The benefits cap is not going to improve that situation at all.
And about any specifics that's been done in terms of campaigns, our analysis to date on women generally, but Carers UK have statistics on the benefits cap, and thousands and thousands of carers are impacted. And if I'm remembering rightly, which seems like a really high figure, but it was an average of £105 per week for those that were affected by it. So, and obviously, carers, or the majority of unpaid carers, are women as well, which links slightly to when you were speaking, Anna, about childcare provision. I was thinking about care, and in previous sessions and in a lot of the work we've done on this, there's points have been made about, of course, we have to get childcare right, but looking at it more broadly in terms of care provision.
Angela.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to make a very brief point. The concluding observations of the UN Committee on the Convention of Elimination of Discrimination Against Women has already highlighted its concerns around the UK government actions in relation to public spending cuts and the impact on women. And so from a human rights perspective already, there is international attention on what's happening in the UK.
Hi.
I just wanted to come back to the references around childcare and the fact that the rights of the child and the entitlement of the child to good quality and just to say, not just a roof over their heads, but one of the drivers for investing in early years was around protecting and investing in the rights of the child. And if we design a childcare system which has that at its heart and guarantees provision for children, including support for babies and children under the age of three, rather than focusing simply on three and four and up, it would alter the way that then everybody interacted with the system, because the child would have the right to a place and that care and that early education and that nurturing from an age which corresponded, dealt with the rights of the child, protected the investment in the child, but also corresponded to the reality of the rest of the systems, which presume that from the age of one, maternity pay and all these other systems stop. So there's a gap in the system, but it isn't meeting the rights of the child. So when we're talking around international obligations, I think there are some avenues there to be explored.
Okay. Jo.
Just to add to that, the UN Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women is about to publish her report later this month following her visit to the UK last year, and certainly welfare reform and the impact of public sector cuts and austerity on women was one of the issues that was raised by a number of organisations during her visit, so I'm sure it will feature in her report on how the UK are failing to meet their obligations to protect women.
Mm-hmm. Well, may come out in time for us to reference it at some point and keep an eye on it. Bill?
The bedroom tax is another area where human rights have been used. One rights for children, disabled children can't be forced to share a room with a non-disabled child or another disabled child with a condition that might actually make them prone to broken bones, etc. A hyperactive child and a child with brittle bone disease sharing the same room. But the bedroom tax cases for disabled adults are now not going to be heard by the Supreme Court until next January, which seems an enormous delay, given that the bedroom tax will then have been in place for nearly 3 years, and those cases were lodged quite early. So we've got a justice delayed is justice denied, and although the human rights are there, I would say that the court system needs to speed itself up in terms of human lives. It's not an effective remedy if you can't get justice for 3 years, or 6 years, or 7 years in cases equal pay, some cases a lot longer than that. I wanted to just one thing. I very much agree with what Angela had said earlier on, that there needs to be a systematic change. One of the things we've been working on lately with Scottish Government, civil servants and Social Security, is specifically on the Scottish Welfare Fund, where we already have powers over, not quite a benefit, but a hardship payment that's paid to people in crisis or in need of specific items. Some of the evidence we gave here was quite negative about disabled people's experience of the Scottish Welfare Fund. And the civil servants came to us and said, well, will you work with us to try and improve the delivery of the service? And we've been working with People First, which is a learning disabled organisation, Highland Users Group, which is mental health service users, and the British Deaf Association, because they've got some of the biggest problems in terms of engaging with the service that's currently there, to design a training package for local authority staff who deliver the service. And it actually brought disabled people and the practitioners together in one place, and I think managed to restore what should have been there from the outset, which is seeing the people in receipt of the service as human beings with specific needs that need to be addressed. And out of that has come a training pack, you know, information materials that are much more accessible and easy read, you know, BSL, etc., and a film which can be used in the future to train new staff coming in to deliver that service to everybody. And I think it will benefit everybody. It won't just benefit disabled users of that service. So, you know, that was my colleagues Sue Kelly and Ian Snedden that worked on that, and Dorothy Ogle from Scottish Government Social Security Division. So, you know, I just wanted to throw in that there is some positive work going on that is an example of how you can co-produce the delivery of a service that actually takes into account, you know, what people's needs are and how best to meet that. So, you know, we need a systemic approach, but we've made a start with the benefit we've got, which is a good thing.
Anyone else? I'll just throw something in. Whenever I've been having discussions personally or even when we've had formal sessions like this, there has obviously been discussions about looking forward to the delivery of Smith and the potential for new devolved powers to be used positively. And when I've asked people to give us specific indications of the types of things they would want to see happening, one that has come up on more than one occasion is, and Engender's paper touches on this, it's about reinstating benefits that have been taken away rather than creating new ones that we've never had before. And one that has cropped up has been maternity grants. I was just wondering if people have got a view on that, or do you have specific ideas of, you know, gender-specific benefits that could be helpful?
On maternity grants, one of my past roles was as chief executive of the NCT, which is the National Childbirth Trust. The maternity grant, which was a grant paid quite late on in pregnancy as a lump sum, it depends what you want to achieve by it, but one of the issues in pregnant women is making sure that they can feed themselves properly, because if your diet is poor in pregnancy, it increases your risk of having a premature baby, which is obviously devastating for the parents and expensive for the state. So there is an argument that actually what is needed is a benefit that's a little amount every week that starts back in early pregnancy. And one of the suggestions was rather than a maternity grant, which is useful as a lump sum for a single large item, but a better way of doing it would be perhaps to think about starting child benefit in pregnancy. So once the woman goes to report her pregnancy to a midwife, child benefit starts perhaps at half the rate from early in pregnancy, allowing the woman sufficient weekly income to meet her nutritional needs. And that would be perhaps a better way of doing it than copying the existing benefit, which wasn't put in with a great deal of thought, I might add. Although it was popular, it didn't achieve the objective that it was set out to achieve.
That's helpful. Anne?
I just wanted to, I might get the country wrong, I think it was Finland, we were doing at the STUC we were doing a training course with Women in Scotland's Economy a couple of weeks ago, and one of the examples there was that there was a box, basically a maternity box, but like not the small scale type of intervention that we have here, but after the baby is born, that there's significant contribution from the state to prams, to clothes, to basic, probably sort of vouchers around provision, but that was completely equal for all families. And I think that 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 type of approach is, I think that's got real potential, and I think that there are things which again could be done if we look at how we spend our budgets in Scotland, which might have, you know, without bringing back a benefit, but would get into some of the, just recognising that bringing children into the world is an important contribution to society, and practically there are ways of providing assistance, but in a way that says the whole of society welcomes this and we will support you, and here is some very practical, serious financial contribution. I mean, the issue of also the cap on child benefit and some of these other things, the cap on maternity benefit they're talking about, those are not obviously good things either and are going to reduce household income. And I think our concern around continually reducing the household income, which is why I kind of made that point earlier about where on paper it might look like there are two wages coming into the house, bringing a baby into that situation where the household income is reducing will not necessarily, from the other evidence we know, protect the health of the mother, who won't necessarily feed herself properly during the first year of that child's life either, you know, because priority is given to the other things that need to be dealt with in the home. So it's important that household income is raised and protected during that period in a way that doesn't, you know, that also protects the mother's health, really. So I think there's some, we were quite interested in that as a proposal, as an idea.
Yeah, sure.
I wanted to pick up on what you said about our report mentioning reinstatement of benefits for certain groups. I think we mentioned carers and parents. I think the point there is really a broader one about compensation for what has been lost, because obviously so much has been taken from women's income. So it's kind of a broader point about a gender budget analysis that looks at where the money's come from and looks at how to then remedy that or to redress it. One particular thing that springs to mind is carers' allowance and the restrictions on there about full-time care. And obviously there's so many young women, older women that are providing part-time care, so flexibility within that model would be something we could look at if possible. I also wanted to jump back to an issue that we haven't really talked about today but came up quite a lot in the previous evidence session, which was about universal credit and the administration of it. And obviously, it looks like we are going to get the power over administration of universal credit, so we could do something very different there about how it's paid, when, and to whom, because Anne's points about household really touches on intra-household dynamics and who controls the spend. So that's another very gendered, live issue.
Lisa.
Not specific to universal credit, but just picking up on that issue of dependency and dynamics within the household, it's something that we've found is really happening in the situation with refugee families and refugee women in particular, where there's a real dependency, whether that's on a partner for the household income or whether that's on discretionary sources of subsistence, such as the Scottish Welfare Fund that was mentioned by Bill, or social work services payments for families with children. There's a specific issue for refugees around the allocation of national insurance numbers, which is causing significant delays in access to benefits payments, and refugees have 28 days to move on from Home Office provided asylum support to mainstream welfare, and data from our service evaluation that's going to be published in a couple of weeks has found that it actually takes between on average 42 and 50 days after refugees receive status to receive any benefits payments. So there's a big gap there, and that's an administrative gap that's currently being plugged by discretionary forms of payment. And when national insurance numbers are allocated, they're almost always allocated to the main asylum applicant, which is usually a male head of household. So the female, often female spouse, is not actually being allocated a national insurance number until several weeks down the line. And 40% of our clients required significant advocacy to even access a national insurance number from our service. So it's probably an underrepresentation of the issue. And we've found that the benefits that are predominantly claimed by women among our clients are the ones that take the longest to be processed. So ESA, income support, child benefit and child tax credit are taking between 46 and 77 days on average to be received by people. And these are people whose women and families whose support will end after 28 days. So they're effectively being left destitute for a period of time. And that's purely because of administrative delay. So there are issues there that really need to be addressed. And at the moment, it's local authorities and the Scottish Welfare Fund that's picking up the gap there. And I think something really needs to change there. And for family reunion, the situation is particularly problematic around dependency, because all the rights and entitlements to benefit comes through the usually male refugee head of household, and the female and children who are joining that person don't have any rights in their own name. So all the benefits, once they are processed, go through the male head of household, the sponsor's bank account, and the women in the family don't have any access to, don't have any financial independence within that scenario. And I'm sure that's something that chimes with, I can see Joe's hand is up.
Jo, do you want to add that?
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, I mean, I think that's something that we would strongly urge the Scottish Government and this committee to consider when looking at the administration of universal credit. If Scotland does have the ability to change the payment system to not just to one person in the household, which will normally be the male head of household model. It's something that some research has just recently been done by our colleagues in Women's Aid England with the TUC, asking women who are experiencing domestic abuse whether they would, because the DWP do offer the alternative payment arrangement for specific cases where there is domestic abuse, you can request a payment to be split. And women have said that they would in no way would they be able to do that, because it would put them at greater risk if they were trying to assert their any control over the money that was coming into the house. So it's important that the administration is split at the very beginning, not at as a request process.
Okay, Anne.
We would support that from the STUC in terms of individualising and entitlement right from the beginning. I just wanted to, there isn't time to discuss this in detail, but I can see it's referenced in some of the paperwork, is the issue of self-employment and the disproportionate and rapid increase there has been amongst self-employment amongst women, which we know isn't corresponding to a higher tax take, basically. So it's probable that many of these women are struggling financially, or at least not in a very high income situation, and the interrelationship between that and an inflexible benefit system and some of the possible consequences around universal credit and the administration of the system need to be looked at. And I think there's something that perhaps could be explored in more detail with a number of different organisations in the future. But the labour market statistics are showing that change, and everybody's noticing the change, but we're not having a discussion about what this might mean for some of the policy initiatives that are coming forward.
Just a very quick point to follow up on what Anne was saying about self-employed women. So although the numbers are growing, but we know as well that women's experience of running their own business is that they face significant barriers, and the reasons that they start their own businesses in the first place is often because they've been forced out of the labour market because they haven't been able to access flexible working, or they've had problems with childcare, or they haven't been able to get promoted because they have other responsibilities. Work done by Women's Enterprise Scotland in particular have identified that women experience significant problems trying to grow their business from a lack of gender-specific support and also just investment as well. So they are concentrated among the lowest paid self-employed people.
Angela.
Thank you. Just to reinforce and to add to the list, I think top of the list is to support comments made by colleagues about universal credit and the urgency with which that the issues around payment and designated recipients have to be addressed. Other things to add to the list, I think, of recommendations, convener, would be comments already made about the level and direction of carers' allowance. Using the future powers to remove employment tribunal fees, where we've seen a 91% fall in sex discrimination cases, primarily pregnancy and maternity related discrimination. So again, the cumulative effects of women losing their jobs on pregnancy and maternity related, having no access to justice, and then coming headlong into the kinds of benefit system that we've been discussing today. Colleagues last week, particularly Howard Reid and Diane Elson, talked about the impact on levels of transfers and cash benefits through the change in the uprating system. That needs to be looked at again, where we've seen a loss of income across the piece because of the change in the uprating system. And the final, I think, recommendation that colleagues have already touched on in terms of gender budget analysis and ensuring that's part of the committee's, this committee and other committees' scrutiny of draft spending plans and other revenue raising plans as well, and gender budget analysis applied across the piece going forward would be a strong recommendation.
Specifics, just going to job seekers allowance. If the sort of guidance on easements could be made regulations, that would be helpful. And the easement around domestic violence is too complicated and insufficient. If there, a sanction is applied, it would be helpful if job seekers' allowance wasn't lost completely, because then the risk of you lose other benefits if you have no job seekers' allowance. And most of all, making sure that what's available is communicated to the people applying for job seekers allowance, so how the rules actually operate, how to appeal and what to do if you are sanctioned need to be communicated. If I had a magic wand, maternity allowance is below the minimum wage, and if Scotland could make maternity payments at least at the minimum wage, that would be very helpful indeed.
Okay. Yeah.
One additional recommendation from our perspective in the Smith Commission, it talked about the executive devolution of asylum support to the Scottish Parliament and to Scotland. So we would see that as an opportunity to create a system of support for people in the asylum process that doesn't have a gap between when they're granted refugee status, that it doesn't have this unacceptable gap that causes people who have rights and entitlements to be destitute. So if there was a support system implemented locally that could ensure end-to-end support for people who are entitled to that support, then that would be simple solution.
Suzanne?
It is just about all about support. Most of them we're speaking to are completely unaware of what's going to happen to them. It's still very much an unknown entity, and I suppose it's about support through the system. Many of them only know the part of the benefit system that they access, and they don't know what we'll face in the future. And I think it's about making sure there's support there at the heart of it, because much of the detail most women don't know about, and they are at the mercy of the advisor they have. So make sure a good support system.
Okay. Annabelle.
Oh, thanks, Convener.
Oh, sorry, I'll come to you, Belinda, after I take Annabelle.
A lot of what I was going to ask has been covered, so I won't duplicate the process. I was very struck by a recurring theme in all the submissions about this whole issue of training in job centres, about better availability of advice to claimants. And the point you raised, Bill, which is the provision of a service appropriate to women in certain circumstances, which I think made a very powerful, or had a very powerful resonance with us all. I'm just wondering, I mean, whether elements of benefit or welfare are reserved to Westminster, or whether they are devolved to the Scottish Parliament, it seems to me that these issues cross borders, wherever the provision is coming from. And I just wondered if there was a place for every job centre having to appoint, if you like, women dedicated officers, someone appointed within the job centre to specifically deal with an issue that arises concerning a woman claimant, rather than perhaps what seems to be at the moment, well, you come in, you need to see someone, that's the person you'll see.
You will have a designated officer who looks after the claim throughout the time that after they've signed on for the first time, after they've made their first claim. But yeah, I think there should be some allowance for people to be able to request seeing a woman worker rather than a male worker, because of what we've already discussed, mental health issues that might make dealing with a male job centre worker quite difficult, because you're having to disclose very personal details. I think it's difficult to disclose it even to a woman, but maybe slightly less fraught than otherwise. But I do agree that I also think there needs to be more training that's aimed at delivering a humane approach mm-hmm. in dealing with people, because I think that people in the system are not being treated as human beings. They're being treated as other, and anything that's done to them is fair, because we know that some of them are fraudulent claims. So because there are less than 1% of people who are defrauding the system, 990 out of 1,000 are being treated as though they're attempting to defraud it, when they are in fact genuine in their claims. And we need to reverse that. Sure, look after public funds, but don't treat everybody as a criminal because a few people are. I think that's one of the lessons. And working with job centre staff, there should be people from Women's Aid, disabled people's organisations, rape crisis, etc., working with staff to try and alert them to what some of the issues are that women are facing in the job market.
I would agree. I think there's definitely room for training and awareness raising among job centre staff. We've been working with DWP to develop a refugee customer journey to provide a masterclass to frontline workers who are delivering service to refugees, so that they better understand their needs and experiences and where they're coming from. But I think there's only so much you can do through training and awareness, and at the end of the day, these problems, systemic problems, still exist because the system is punitive and it's not supporting women into work. It's not supporting women who need that support through social security. So yes, definitely there's room for training, but I don't think that's the answer.
Okay.
Very quickly, obviously one of the trade unions, the PCS, which represents members who are employed through DWP and so on, has the union PCS has raised repeated concerns with the UK government about the staffing levels and the cutbacks and the closures of some of the job centres. And I think there is a real issue there about capacity. That's not to say that obviously training is important. But there's an issue which has been well flagged up about the move to call centres, the move away from face-to-face, the move to having to apply online is, in my view, completely discriminatory for a whole range of reasons which we don't have time to go into just now. But I just wanted to flag up that there are also workers trying to deliver a service without adequate resources and in a context where it's a punitive system. So when the redesign takes place and when we look at what could be done in Scotland fairly quickly, there may be ways that we can look at staffing levels and additional supports around job centres, in terms of the delivery and not moving immediately to everything having to be done online, whatever, there are other ways that possibly we can bring in extra public resources and recognise that some of the cuts at local authority level have withdrawn some of the advocacy and some of the supports and some of the, like, library closures that make it harder for people to access the internet. And, there's a whole number of issues there which are bound up, but where we could possibly make some change when we look at the whole Scottish spend prior to rolling out some of the changes that Claire identified.
Melinda, you wanted to make a point earlier. I cut you off before you were able to make it.
I think what everybody's asking for is that whilst there are things that we can do to make the current system less bad, an ideal solution is a redesign, that if Scotland could make that happen in Scotland, which would enable everybody to have a life that involves work and earning enough money to live and covers their caring responsibilities, and which is designed knowing that until things dramatically change in the world, men and women have different lives, and we need a system that does not unfairly penalise women or women with other disadvantages in the way that it does at the moment. And I think our wish would be that Scotland would have the powers it needs to create that system as an example to show that it can be done.
I'm happy to take final contributions. I know you'll have come here this morning hoping to make various points. If you haven't got all the points that you wanted to get across, now's your chance to do it.
I've made all the points I want to make, but I've got copies of the report that we've just published. It was only released over the weekend for members of the committee. And I think that will tell you a lot of the problems that people are facing in fairly harrowing detail. There are case studies, but there's also, you know, been some quantitative work in it. And I think it's fairly impressive piece of work. And certainly I'll leave it here for members of the committee.
Anyone else? Nina.
Just one thing that hasn't been mentioned is around the English language requirement, and you mentioned people for whom English isn't their first language and how they experience the system. And just I'd like to raise a few concerns about the English language requirement, and it's again another example of inflexibility, and learners are, we've heard it's still to be seen how it's going to play out because it's quite new, but we've had learners telling us that they've been told their own language assessments are confidential and they can't access them, so they're going through a mandatory system where they're not able to access their own assessments. It's provision that's only speaking and listening, and if you're currently in ESOL provision that's provided by a provider in Scotland or a college in Scotland, you have to leave that, you have to withdraw yourself from that course to do the mandatory DWP provided provision, and that's only speaking and listening, it doesn't include reading and writing. And there's a kind of whole host of concerns around it, and on the one hand it's a good thing that there's more access to ESOL classes for people and that it's actually child friendly, but on the other hand it's very inflexible and it doesn't suit women who prefer more flexible learning and community-based learning at all. So there's some concerns about that, and I think in terms of the new ESOL strategy in Scotland, what can Scotland do to try to influence that and ensure that the provision is better linked up and more holistic?
Okay. Anyone else? Jo.
Just briefly, we haven't had the opportunity to touch on the impact of the cuts to EU migrants in Scotland. Particularly women experiencing domestic abuse who have no recourse to public funds in certain situations, and where they have no entitlement to housing benefit and are unable to access refuge accommodation as a result. I know that a number of women's aid groups in Scotland have made submissions to the committee giving case studies on this, and I would urge the committee to really have a look at what mitigating measures can be taken to protect, ensure women in that situation are protected.
Yeah, sure, we'll do that. Have the report include that type of information. Is there anything else that people want to contribute? And obviously, if you go away and you come across more information or there's something that you think that our report would benefit from including, please let us know. This isn't your only opportunity to inform us and guide us in the direction that we need to go. So at any time any information emerges which you think our report could benefit from, please let us have it. I think we had some very substantial and challenging information given to us this morning that we'll take forward. We're going to produce our report after the summer and have a debate in the Parliament on it. So hopefully you'll see some of those recommendations included, and we'll take it forward in that way. But on behalf of the committee, thanks very much to you all for your contributions this morning. I certainly found it very informative and helpful, so thank you for coming along. Okay, and I'll suspend the meeting for a few minutes before we take our next. I continue with our evidence on our Women in Social Security inquiry. This second panel is made up of organisations which have a particular interest in the impact on children and families. So we welcome before us Mark Ballard, Head of Policy at Barnardo Scotland, Hanna McCulloch, Policy and Parliamentary Officer at the Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland, and Marion Davis, Head of Policy and Research, One Parent Families Scotland. Do you have any opening comments that you want to make? Have you prepared anything or discussed it amongst yourselves that you're going to lead us off, or would you prefer we just go to questions?
I suppose having listened to the first session, I thought it was worth flagging up some of the specific reforms that are having such a big disproportionate impact on women and children and families specifically. It was research, I think, that was prepared for this committee that found that the average household in Scotland was losing something like £440 a year as a result of welfare changes altogether. But for a lone parent family, that's closer to £1,800, which is huge from households that are traditionally low income anyway. So the reforms that the IFS have said have made the biggest difference in terms of child poverty, the biggest difference is uprating and changes to the way benefits have been uprated from year to year, and particularly child benefit. A family with two children has lost £1,100 over the last 4 years in terms of a reduction in the way that child benefit is uprated alone. So that is very much something that I think needs to be addressed. Tax credits, the removal of the baby element of tax credits, and changes to the way tax credits are being administered is particularly affecting low-income families. There's been a more hardline approach taken by HMRC in terms of recovering overpayments of tax benefits. There used to be a cap on how much money HMRC could take back that is now gone, and overpayments are being taken back in huge chunks, which is leaving families in a really difficult position. The benefit cap as well, as you'd already touched on, and the residence test that's being applied to EEA nationals is having a disproportionate impact on women, because if you now have to have a job or a genuine prospect of having a job within 3 months of being in the country rather than 6 months, which means as women are less likely to be able to find employment quickly because of caring responsibilities, they're losing access to a wide range of benefits. And also because people seeking work are no longer entitled to housing benefit if they're EEA nationals, women who leave relationships, whether it's for domestic violence or other reasons, and lose their right to reside, can no longer access housing benefits. So that was just a rundown of the main specific reforms and the specific impact they're having on children with families.
Mark?
And I think for Barnardo's, I think probably like a lot of organisations, we were aware that welfare changes were having a disproportionate effect on women. But I was shocked that the figure was as high as 85% of the impact of welfare changes being on women. And that means that in many ways, when we talk about the impact of welfare changes on children, as you would expect from Barnardo's, we're actually talking about the impact of welfare changes on women and children, and the two go together. And when we think about the child poverty strategy, for example, which is an area that Barnardo's, along with CPAG and One Parent Family Scotland, have been very involved in, actually that Engender statistic changes some of the way I think we have to think about the child poverty strategy. If you look at the current Scottish child poverty strategy, it does very clearly make the link between women and child poverty. It highlights on page 8 of the 2014 to 2017 child poverty strategy that groups that face a significantly higher risk of poverty include single parents, families with three or four more children, families containing a disabled person, and we heard particular evidence from Bill Scott earlier about the impact on families with disabled children. If you look at the most recent quarterly poverty briefing from the Scottish Government, it highlights in particular when it's looking at severe poverty, that looking at groups at risk of severe and extreme poverty, young mothers are twice have a 17% likelihood of being in severe or extreme poverty compared to all mothers on 8%. It highlights the impact of being a lone parent, of having a disability. So there are strong links between that are already quite clear between women and poverty, but I don't think they're brought out nearly enough in current child poverty approaches in Scotland. And Hanna outlined in her evidence some of the things that have happened and which have had disproportionate impacts on women, in particular tax credits and the impact on women with low incomes, that we heard in the earlier group, the impact of women being moved onto job seekers allowance, when lone parents being moved onto job seekers allowance, who are predominantly women, when their youngest child turns 5. Looking forward in terms of some of the discussion of where the £12 billion of welfare cuts might come from, there's been a lot of emphasis on young people, on moving 18 to 21-year-olds onto youth allowances, on restricting housing benefit access for young people, the impact on those with larger families through things like the benefit cap, and although it now seems less likely, restricting child benefit to larger families. So taken as a whole, I think when we think about child poverty, and we should recognise much more explicitly that actually social security for women and child poverty go hand in hand, because it isn't the children who are poor, it's their parents who are poor. The impact of welfare reform is hitting the mothers of those children disproportionately, as we heard from Engender. We know that the particular likelihood of lone parents being in poverty. So I think we need a much more integrated approach between the child poverty conversation that doesn't take place in this committee, that takes place predominantly in the Health Committee and the Education and Culture Committee, and the social security conversation that takes place here.
Marion, did you want to add anything?
Yes, we were very pleased when the committee decided to look at women in welfare, because 92% of single parents are women, and a lot of the impacts around women with children are impacting on single parents. In our submission, we looked at income adequacy, and as Hanna has said, the impact of changes to benefits rates and the freezing of benefits. We also looked at the whole new regime, the sanctions regime, and that has had a big impact on single parents, not only in terms of the impact of a reduction in benefit, but also the impact on health and well-being as well, which I can sort of go into in more detail later. But also, thirdly, in relation to employability, and we felt that that was very important, that welfare reform has had a major impact on single parents in terms of access to training and education. So although we've been talking about benefits, there is this broader brush kind of policy context. I was interested in Mark saying about young parents and the fact that they are flagged up as a group which really have suffered in terms of income, but sometimes we forget, like in the avalanche in a sense of so many benefit changes, that young parents actually are paid less benefits than older parents, and that's actually going to become worse because the age is going to move up to 25. So there's an issue around the whole thing to do with young parents as well. So just to echo what the other two have said, really around single parents and the gender perspective, we've always felt it's very, very important to highlight that one of the reasons that single parents are in poverty is actually because the majority are women.
Mark, you indicated, or you used the figure of the £12 billion impending cuts. There is speculation that child benefit is going to be one of the targets in terms of that. Can you just give us an idea of how that is going to impact on top of what's already happening. If you've done any analysis of, you know, where these cuts fall, who's going to suffer most, and how large is that impact going to be?
It's very hard to, at this stage, understand what the picture is going to be, because there's still a lack of clarity about how that £12 billion reduction in welfare spending is going to come about. Obviously, there's a degree of optimism that you could achieve that £12 billion reduction in welfare spending because people move off welfare into employment. But for many of the families that we work with, the support that they need, the reason why we're working with them, is one of the reasons why that they're not able to move into employment yet. So it's a very unclear picture where those £12 billion of cuts are going to come. Our concern has always been to highlight the potentially unintended consequences of those cuts, that we know that if there was a move to reduce housing benefit for families with more than two children, that would put those families at greater risk of falling into crisis, and there would then be no more need for an intervention by local authorities to support those families, and potentially organisations like Barnardo's to support those families. So it's a very hard picture to work out. I was very struck by on a related issue, by a recent report that came out from the End Youth Homelessness Coalition with research from Heriot Watt University, which was looking at a similar issue around the impact of removing housing benefit from 18 to 21-year-olds. And while there is a potential net saving of around 130 million if you simply took all housing benefit away from that group, if you look more closely at those figures, there would need to be some kind of exemption, particularly given what we're discussing, exemptions for lone parents and other families who had children but were aged under 21, where there's a recognition that it would make no sense to take housing benefit off those groups. If you go through the exemptions, if you add in a prediction of the impact of increased homelessness amongst young people, if you took housing benefit away from those young people, a saving that appears to be £130 million, because that's the cost of housing benefit to 18 to 21-year-olds, dwindles down to £2 or £3 million. And that's simply not worth doing. If there was even a slightly higher rate of homelessness, then those savings would disappear. So when we talk about welfare savings, because of the need for necessary exemptions, because of the need, the impact on other services, in this case it would be local authorities who were having to support families who, individuals under 21 rather, who declared as homeless, those savings all disappear. And that's where it's still very unclear how you would actually deliver those kind of savings in welfare without having a massive unintended consequences, follow-on costs, and cause misery and poverty to the people who currently rely on those benefits.
I was just going to say specifically in relation to child benefit. I think child benefit is a particularly important benefit for women, and a particularly important benefit at the moment, because it tends to be paid to the carer of the child in the household, which tends to be the woman. So it's often paid directly to the woman, giving her control over it. And particularly at the moment, when we're seeing so many suspensions and sanctions and delays and these kind of things, child benefit tends to remain constant. So it's a guarantee of some income to households with children when difficulties lead to other benefits being suspended. The fact that it's universal or close to universal now means uptake is very high, and I think in terms of where to invest money to ensure that low-income families are benefiting, from our perspective, child benefit is absolutely vital, and so cuts there would be devastating for us, and the proposed freeze for the next 2 years on child benefit will have an extremely detrimental impact.
Yeah. Marion, do you have a view on that?
Yeah, I mean, we would be incredibly upset about child benefit, being reduced or cut. And as Hannah said, in relation to conditionality and sanctions, that child benefit is the one constant. And, you know, we've seen a massive increase in parents with children going to food banks in Glasgow. It's, you know, an absolute explosion. And, you know, our staff are dealing with that on a daily basis. We're meeting young pregnant women in Lanarkshire where we have a project who, because they haven't eaten, our staff have to take them to Tesco's to get something to eat before we can even address any of the other issues that we should be, you know, kind of, we should be looking at. And the JRF have got an annually uprated minimum income standard, and what they've shown is that a single mother can now only afford 57% of that level, and to make further cuts really would be devastating, I think. And I mean, we said in our submission that we don't believe in forced destitution as a policy instrument, and I think we're seeing some of that at the moment, which you know, has an impact on children and their families, and it's very sad to see.
Yeah, I would concur with you on that. Kevin.
Thank you, Convener. One of the other things which we've heard a lot about over the past couple of weeks is the reduction in the household benefit cap from £26,000 to £23,000. And we know from analysis that that will put tens of thousands more children into poverty. Can I ask the panel what they think the impacts of that will be on these kids? Do they think that this short-term gain will have a major effect on the public purse in the future? And what do they expect to have to deal with in their organisations if that policy is implemented and if even more kids are pushed into poverty?
The cases that we've seen where the benefits cap has been applied in Scotland at the moment, it tends to be people with very high housing costs. And as I say, the cases that we've seen, and I don't want to say that this is the only group affected, but it tends to be large families, often lone parent families, that are leaving a relationship. Maybe it's due to domestic violence, in some cases not, but are then in temporary accommodation, which is very expensive, which takes them over the benefit cap.
Come in there, Hanna. So the money which is being paid for the housing is going directly to the landlord, whoever they may be, rather than to the family, which many folk think actually happens. So that housing cost, the cost of that housing for large families in the main, as you say, doesn't go anywhere near that family anyway, that money. It goes directly to the landlord.
Yes, at the moment. But I would say that when the benefit cap is applied, it is housing benefit at the moment that it's taken from. And it will be the housing element of universal credit, is my understanding. So in terms of what the impact of a lower benefit cap would be, my understanding is that at the moment the impact would be on landlords and local authorities in terms of making discretionary housing payments. And the lower the cap, the more families, and a wider variety of families will be caught by this, because at the moment it's largely the majority of cases are in England where housing prices are higher, obviously.
Or in places like Aberdeen, of course,
yeah.
Or here in Edinburgh.
Yeah.
I spoke earlier about the need to have a more explicit link between the child poverty approach and women and social security. I think I'd also like to highlight the clear links we need to make between the GEFEC approach to getting it right for every child. And I think that's the main thrust of Kevin Stewart's point. I was talking recently to staff at a long-standing service we have working with children who are at risk of being excluded from school. And the reality is that the increasing driver for those children's behaviour at school is that the family is in financial crisis. And that financial crisis comes when, as a combination of the reduction in family income that's come from the benefit changes, and then a sudden crisis when there's suddenly some unaffordable repairs that need to be done, when a benefit sanction is applied, when there's a delay to benefits, and you can see the knock-on effect of that, of those benefit changes and the impact of those benefit changes on the child's performance at school. And we know the long-term negative impact that school exclusion has on children. So there is a very clear link back in terms of the services we have, which are not there as anti-poverty services. They're there to tackle things like supporting children to stay in mainstream schools. But they actually are coping with the consequences of welfare reform. And if we want a Scotland where we do get it right for every child, and where we actually look at what's in, where we look at the national performance framework, where we're talking about improving the life chances for children, young people and families at risk, then there's a very clear link between some of the things that are putting families at risk, like the impact of benefit caps, of benefit sanctions, and work that we need to do to make sure that every child in Scotland has the best start in life.
Yeah, I just wanted to, I suppose, touch on the case that went to the Court of Appeal, the Supreme Court, and was actually taken by CPAG and involved two single mothers who went to the appeal court to say that the benefit cap discriminated against women. The appeal court found against that, but what they did say was that the cap does discriminate against women, but that this discrimination was not manifestly without reasonable foundation and was therefore lawful. So although it discriminates against women, it was lawful. And the reason I mentioned that this particular decision was that in addition to that, three of the judges said that although it was upheld as lawful, there was criticism that it was not in line with the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, which the UK government has signed up to, and within which requires the Westminster government to comply with certain levels of support for children. So I think the fact that that decision was made in relation to the benefit cap at that level, it's not really going in the right direction in relation to children's rights and children's wellbeing.
Discriminatory practice, the removal of housing benefit, the proposed removal of housing benefit from young job seekers 18 to 21 year olds, has there been any cases gone to court round about discrimination there? Because obviously, in my mind, that is also discriminatory in terms of an age. Do we know of any?
Not aware. Yeah.
But that's maybe something that will come. And again, as Christina said earlier, it may make things much more difficult if human rights legislation is withdrawn in any way, shape or form. If I could change tack a little bit, Convener, in one parent family's submission, they state, as they stand, the draft clauses set out in the UK government's command paper appear to devolve the work programme to the Scottish government, whilst maintaining the current sanctioning regime, which underpins both referrals to and the policing of the work programme by the DWP. It is difficult to see how such arrangements can be described as devolution in any meaningful way. I wonder if you could comment on that, because it seems a bit bizarre to me that this Parliament may control the work programme, but the DWP will still control sanctioning.
I mean, one of the big changes around single parents has been the requirement to sign on when your child's five, and then become part of the job seeker regime, which means that you have to sort of sign on and look for work. But also part of the new welfare to work regime, we have the work programme, and a high percentage of single parents who, when they've signed on after a year, then go on to the work programme, which at the minute is held by private contractors, and in Scotland that is Working Links and INGIUS. So in a sense, single parents, when they move into to that part of the pathway,
they become very difficult to contact and to keep in touch with. It's very difficult to find out information about how things work within the work programme because, in a sense, it's a private sector sort of contract and there's business interest. But we have found through our engagement with single parents is that the work programme itself is not well geared up to the needs of single parents, that it's very work-first and work-focused. And what sits behind that is the same conditionality regime that's in place for job seekers, and it means that you know, if a single parent doesn't comply with certain conditions, then she may lose some of her benefit. So we feel that that approach, and we've talked about sanctions in our submission, is not the correct one. We would rather see lone parents supported along the employability pathway and into work through a supportive framework rather than being sanctioned. And the last time we looked at sanctions was around about 9,000 single parents had been sanctioned in Scotland, and we could only find that out through a Freedom of Information Act request. We do have another one in at the moment to try and update those figures. And you know, we feel that in terms of contributing to eradicating child poverty, that particular policy is not at all helpful. And after all, welfare to work is not the broader context was not just to increase the movement into work. It wasn't just about reducing the bill for the taxpayer. It was also about contributing to reducing child poverty. And we can see the trend is the opposite way. You know, CPAG, and I know Hanna will probably mention that too, is that the move is an increase in child poverty. And so we would be concerned about the work programme being devolved without that part of it being devolved along with it. So there's full control over how that part of welfare to work pans out.
Finally, I recognise that all of your organisations have contributed greatly to our work here and to the reports that we have written. Can I ask, in terms of your lobbying of the DWP and the Westminster government, are you continuously lobbying? And do you feel that you're being listened to in any way, shape or form by the DWP in terms of the changes that they are about to introduce?
Mark, if I can tell what I hope is a positive story on this, that David Mundell gave evidence to this committee some time ago and made a commitment to meet with organisations working on child poverty in Scotland, including Barnardo Scotland, and I assume CPAG and One Parent Family Scotland. We discussed with Mr Mundell the UK government's Access All Areas programme, which is designed to ensure that the specific needs of young people who've left care anywhere in the UK, if it applies to the DWP, are taken into account in processes. We had a positive response from Mr Mundell, and he looked at DWP policy. While there's a high level commitment at the DWP to the Access All Areas approach, its implementation appears to be patchy, and we look forward to working with Mr Mundell, now he has returned to the Scotland office, to follow up to make sure that Access All Areas is the approach that's taken, not just at a strategic level, but by every individual Job Centre Plus. So we get that kind of care flagging of young people, which would particularly apply to sanctions. And I'm grateful to the committee for the fact that it facilitated that process with Mr Mundell. But that in a way, leads on to a point I wanted to make for Kevin Stewart's previous question, that I think the legal framework around sanctions, which was set by Westminster, but there's also the discretion that takes place at a Job Centre Plus level and at an advisor level about how it's applied. Access All Areas is a good example of the way that discussion can be made for care leavers within the existing legal framework. We would like to see much more discussion for individuals with dependent children, particularly in the context we're talking today, women with dependent children, in decisions that are taken by advisers and in job centres. That wouldn't necessarily require a change to the legal framework. It wouldn't necessarily require a change to the legal responsibility. What it would require would be a change in guidance, approach and attitude at an adviser and a Job Centre Plus level. So there are things that can be done within the existing legal structure before we get into conversations about what future responsibility patterns might look like.
I would say on a small scale we have had some success. We do engage with the DWP in Scotland through the customer user group, and they have made small changes. But I would say on a larger scale, when you consider that as an organisation our objective is the eradication of child poverty, and the policies that are proposed in relation to welfare benefits, I mean, we know that 100,000 more children will be living in poverty in Scotland by 2020 than in 2012, largely as a result of welfare reform, and that's before we take into the new freezes on benefits that have been announced, the freeze on child benefit, etc. So that's an indication of how much I feel, I suppose, our findings are taken into account at UK level.
In terms of engaging with DWP, there's different levels. There's the legislative framework, but then there's the operation of what's in place. And I think in terms of the legislative framework, that's there. But I think, as others have touched on, there are ways of implementing the legislation that can be done on a continuum, in a sense. And I think that we put in our submission that there was an opportunity to develop a sort of Scottish good practice approach around the sanctioning regime, because we have the legislation, but then we've got the implementation, and that can go along a continuum, and it can actually change from different geographical areas and different offices. So that you can have some offices that, you know, have extremely high levels of sanctioning, and others that have lower levels. And we've met quite regularly with the partnership managers at Job Centre Plus Scottish wide, and we've tried to sort of do some work with them. They've done some training with our staff to try and explain the legislation. Our staff have fed back to them saying, well, that's the legislation, but in practice, actually on the ground, that's not what's happening. So I think there are opportunities to look, I think particularly around sanctioning, to ensure that actually Job Centre staff are implementing what is actually in the legislation. I mean, there are, for example, lone parent flexibilities whereby Job Centre staff should be taking account of the fact that women with children should be allowed to take their child to school before they go to work, that they should have the appropriate childcare to meet their needs to take up employment, that there should be support in place even when a single parent is on income support to take part in work-related activity. And, you know, that is all there within the legislation, which it has to be said has, you know, kind of has been pulled away in a sense under universal credit. That's, you know, kind of, it's been minimised. But at the minute, that legislation we're finding across the country is not being applied locally. And because, you know, we've got projects across Scotland, and we've done a survey with single parents across different local authorities. It's just an ongoing survey. I think we're at about 150 single parents at the moment. But just looking at that, 85% have said that that welfare reform has had a negative impact. Now, that's a really, really high percentage, and it gives it some credibility in that you're talking about Orkney, Shetland, the borders, you know, Glasgow, Lanarkshire, across the board. So,
Thank you. Convener.
Christina and then Claire.
Much, Convener. Kevin touched on the question that I'd raised with the panel earlier on human rights and all of the issues around that. And can I thank One Parent Family Scotland for drawing my attention, because I was looking for this last night and I couldn't find it, and it's in your notes, I found it there. International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, their monitor actually reported and severely criticised the UK government for failing to meet the fundamental right to food as set out in Article 3. And it's something that's just basic for us all, basic need. And amongst the causes of increased hunger in the UK, it identified the coalition at that point's welfare reforms, including sanctions, as an impact on that. Now, One Parent Family Scotland, actually, I'm hosting a reception for them tonight. So if you want to hear some testimony from some of the young parents that Marion's been talking about, please, you'll be more than welcome to come along. And the Transforming Lives programme, I would suggest, that One Parent Family Scotland does is maybe a bit more fruitful than some of the work programme that I have seen young parents put on. But the question I really wanted to ask was about this issue around about child hunger and how, you know, we can make a difference in this. And one of the things I'd asked a few weeks ago was whether, you know, organisations and lobbying groups would support, you know, quite a strong lobby that an a cumulative impact assessment is done in all of these aspects to ensure that where there's the issues, whether it's a woman, a lone parent, somebody with a disability, you know, children that have got challenges and disabilities themselves, and a cumulative impact assessment be done so that when universal credit is rolled out, it's actually tailored towards the needs of that family, and we're not looking at figures like this when the UK, one of the richest countries in the world, is being criticised for their children being hungry.
In relation to the point on food poverty, I'm not sure if you're aware of the research we did in food banks last year with Trussell Trust and Oxfam, which found that most families accessing food banks were doing so as a result of an income crisis, and in most cases that was a result of an administrative problem with the benefit system, suspension or delay with benefits or sanctions. So we know that is one of the main causes that is leading to children being hungry. I think it's worth noting, I mean, there are things, I was involved in that research and speaking to families in Scotland using food banks. Yes, it's a result largely of UK policies, but there are things that can still be done at Scottish Government level and at local level to avoid families having to use food banks. The Scottish Welfare Fund is one, raising awareness of that fund, because many of the families that we spoke to didn't know it was there. Affordable transport to stop people being sanctioned in the first place. Transport was a really big issue for a lot of families. So while keeping in mind that this is largely a result of sanctions, delays, etc., I think there's also a need to keep the eye on the ball in terms of what we can do now, because the Scottish Government and local authorities have that duty towards the children.
And I think that I completely agree with Hannah's analysis. I think one of the challenges is that as we move to a new world of CPPs, of integrated health and social care bodies, of integrated children's services planning under the Children and Young People Act 2014, that we make sure that addressing child poverty more broadly, but things like food poverty, child hunger, as specific examples of that within all public bodies that are delivering services. And the reality is that poverty, the kinds of poverty we're seeing are changing. It's not just the increase in numbers that Hannah alluded to earlier, the prediction that child poverty will go up by 100,000 children in Scotland. It's that the nature of that poverty is changing too. So it's not just a scale issue, it's about the kinds of poverty, it's about families who are not merely on a low income, but are on no income because of benefit delays and sanctions, and how local authorities, how the wider state relates to that, supports those families, supports those children, looks quite different to previous approaches to poverty. And that's going to be that's going to have to be factored in. And we want to see understanding child poverty more broadly, but also families in destitution more specifically, a central element to future CPP plans, integrated health and social care bodies plans, and so on. Because as we discussed in our previous response to Kevin Stewart's question, the long-term impact of that period of financial crisis can reverberate throughout a child's life if it leads to a school exclusion, for example. That's a long-term impact due to a very short-term failure to meet the needs of a family in crisis.
You picked up on the school exclusion issue, which is a really, you know, clear indication of where an accumulative impact assessment would maybe pick up some of that, and you know how it knocks on to local authorities having to pick up, you know, the pieces on that. But one of the things that the anecdotal evidence that I've got is kids that are going to school hungry and then not being able to function properly at school, therefore not getting the best out of their education, you know, and the whole impact of that, which would be a generational impact. I wonder whether you've got any insight on that.
And I think there's something, we've been reflecting within Barnardo's on the new GERFET guidance, which sets a set of 8 indicators for well-being, and if a child is assessed as having a well-being need, then the named person, which every child in Scotland will be expected to take action to address that well-being need. If a child is in poverty, do they have a well-being need? And if so, what would the named person do to help address that well-being need? That's 20% of children in Scotland at the moment, and a figure that's likely to rise. In some areas of Scotland, that's likely to be a much higher figure. How will the system cope when the primary thing that is undermining the well-being of the child under the terms of the Children and Young People Scotland Act is the fact that that child is growing up in chronic or acute poverty? And so I think you have a mechanism there which is designed to do that kind of cumulative impact assessment on the things that are undermining the well-being of the child. What's lacking at the moment is clarity when it is poverty that is undermining the well-being of the child, what the response is. And so we were certainly reflecting on that in terms of how GERFEC, which is an entirely laudable approach, is going to work in practice. But a child cannot have well-being if, as you say, that they have an inadequate diet. If they're hungry, they don't have well-being.
Yeah, thanks. We would be very supportive of a cumulative impact assessment. And I think a lot of organisations have requested that, but I think Westminster have not yet came up with a kind of process to be able to sort of do that. In terms of like food and hunger, in relation to very practical areas, for example, looking at breakfast clubs. That's why in our submission to Glasgow City Council we're putting a very strong support to the continuation of breakfast clubs, and you know, if there's changes or cuts to services, that services like these are actually crucial and preventative as well, in a sense. And One Parent Family Scotland has also for many years supported the Free School Meals campaign as well, which also kind of coming in at it from another angle ensures that all children have a healthy, high quality meal, no matter what the circumstances of their parents. But in relation to, cumulative assessment and narrowing that down a bit, it was just to refer to the committee of the committee to the Work and Pensions Committee report on sanctions beyond Oakley, and in that they said that they called for a comprehensive independent review of the sanctions regime. And I think that that would be a great start, because we may then identify the fact that, and actually the Work and Pensions Committee had this in their report, was that financial sanctions are not any more successful than any other method of ensuring that welfare to work works. And there's lots of international research around that, and we touched on it in our submission. That is not necessarily the most successful way of having a successful welfare to work strategy. And if you want that welfare to work strategy to contribute to eradicating child poverty, it certainly isn't the right strategy.
Thank you.
Clear, and then Margaret.
Just been touching on the area that I kind of wanted to cover. Obviously, we've taken quite a bit of evidence. We had a one-off evidence session on the effect of welfare reform on children's services, and we're hearing that children's services budgets are overspent. It's reported that a lot of that is to do with mental health issues as a result of either the sanctions regime or indeed in-work poverty. So when we talk about the savings to the overall savings to the benefits budget in terms of what's been proposed, what we're getting is a picture of the societal costs being much bigger and the cumulative societal cost being a much greater impact in the long term than the one-off savings that we're getting. So I wondered if you had any budgetary evidence or even any evidence of the impact on your individual organisations in terms of where you would have wanted to be and the work you would have been wanting to do now in terms of GIRFEC, in terms of tackling child poverty, and really what the impact is on you and the capacity you have in the future to continue to pick up the societal cost of what's being brought upon people.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with what you're saying in terms of the impact on, firstly, the child and the impact and the cost in terms of their life and also in terms of local services. CPAG has done research on the cost of child poverty, and I'm struggling to remember the exact figure, but it's something like 26 billion, it's estimated, to cost the UK economy each year in terms of lost economic activity, health problems and welfare payments as a result of child poverty. So we know that. We're also seeing through the cases, a lot of the cases you see through the early warning system, it's extremely clear that the knock-on impact is immediate and large. So with sanction cases, we'll often see people having mental health problems and having to access services because of that. There are some cases where people have got into trouble with the police because they have been desperate. All these things have a huge cost in terms of public services, and I think that would be a mapping of the true cost of one sanction would be a really interesting piece of work to do, and I think it would sharpen the minds of service planners and people who are making budgeting decisions to see in front of them exactly how much they are saving by not investing in preventative services.
And Hanna brought us onto the territory. I wanted to mention that we've really welcomed the cross-party commitment to the Christie Commission principles about preventative spend. But what we see are local authorities who want to do that preventative spend work but can't because the crisis management that they're having to do is simply too expensive for them to properly invest in preventative spend. And services that we have, which are funded and supported by local authorities because they're part of a preventative effort, actually the threshold for accessing those services is going up and up because the services that are for families in more serious crisis provided by the local authority are overflowing. So we get the overspill of families who are in more severe crisis than our service is supposed to be working with, which means that the families were a light touch, early intervention, preventative spend approach would be of most benefit, don't get to our service. And so that logic, the logic of preventative spend starts to unravel when the level of crisis face goes up so significantly. And that's a common report from our services, that because we have long-standing services, they know that the families that they're working with are not the families that they should be working with, but the families that we're supporting are the ones who are in such a level of crisis that we can't turn them away, because often they haven't got the support they need from the statutory, the centrally supported statutory services. So it's a very difficult situation where that emphasis on preventative spend is being undermined by increasing levels of crisis. And the Christie Commission had fantastic statistics that I'm sure you're all very familiar with about the benefits of a preventative spend approach in terms of the long-term savings that generates.
Yeah, I guess there's been a fair bit of research on the impact of sanctions and cuts to benefit, but perhaps not so much on the threat of sanctions and the impact on health and wellbeing. In terms of our survey that we've been doing, we've obviously had the figures side of it, but we've had a lot of parents who've sent in comments, things like, really terrible, it made my life very difficult for me. In fact, my health has suffered from the stress. Another parent, all I know is I'm struggling really badly to get by, and it's sometimes a desperate feeling to be told by the brew to pull your socks up and to be positive when it's hard to give your kids a decent life. So that kind of thing has, you know, a severe impact on mental health and well-being. And in a very sort of reverse logic kind of way, reduces the chance of moving into employment, because actually to move into work, you know, and we all know, you know, you have to have a level of confidence, you have to be able to do well at a job interview, you have to feel that you can cope with work. And I think like some of the policies in place are actually detrimental to that mindset, and are resulting in ill health actually. And so therefore I think more research on all of that would be useful as well, I think, and would impact on this cumulative impact that we maybe is not so easy to measure or to see sort of on the surface. Okay.
Margaret.
Thank you. Since 2012, the single parent has to claim JSA from when their youngest child turns 5. But I read with concern, and I think it was the single Marion's submission, that in addition, sanctions can now also be imposed on single mothers claiming income support when their youngest child is 1 year old. And, you know, mothers have to claim employment support allowance if, you know, they're on income support or because of due ill health. So I just wonder how widespread that is. And, you know, it just seems unbelievable. I mean, if a mother's to work, you know, they need childcare. So also just the childcare provision. So I suppose my question is around how widespread this is around young mothers having to claim benefit or their benefit circumstances changing when their child is as young as 1. And also, you know, what are the child provision for women in this case?
Yeah, I think welfare reform has impacted on single parents with children under 5 as well, and a lot of the focus has been around job seekers and lone parents who are claiming job seekers allowance. But when on income support, the conditionality has racked up, and there is a requirement to attend work-related interviews when the children are younger. And then as the parent's youngest child gets nearer 3 and 4, there's work-related activity which is now required in relation to claiming income support. So in terms of sanctioning, the sanctioning is not as severe as being on job seekers allowance in terms of like the time span and the amount. But for example, if you miss an appointment to meet your advisor, you can be sanctioned. And we've had a lot of cases where single parents maybe they haven't been able to attend an appointment because of lack of childcare, or because perhaps their children have been unwell or they themselves have been unwell. We've had cases of pregnant young women who, because you still have to sign on until a certain point when you're nearer having your baby, been unable to sign on a particular day because they had really severe morning sickness, and been sanctioned because of that. So it definitely has become more stringent. And the Freedom of Information Act request that I mentioned earlier, actually there were more single parents with children under 5 had been sanctioned than those who were on job seekers. I think it was just over sort of 5,000, but we hope to have like updated figures on that. So I think, yes, that is something that's not had such a high profile, and I think it's indicative just of the trend in relation to welfare to work for single parents, kind of in a way following the American model, which is very much work first, and not so much what we previously had, which was more human capital, looking at the person's potential skills, how they can move into to sort of better paid employment. So it's indicative of that sort of general framework of the way policy is developed.
Mark, did you want to comment?
I think the issue here is about the lack of integration between different systems, and the example which we cited in our evidence was our services working with a mother with a four-year-old child, the mother having had a history of severe substance misuse problems, but Bernardo's working with her to move her towards more positive destinations. But the panic and fear that that woman has, because she knows that, in as Marion described, in a few months' time, she's going to be moved onto JSA, and she doesn't feel that she could cope with work, and the danger that the blind imposition of the rules around the transition onto JSA could undermine all the work and all the investment that's been put into securing better opportunities for her. And obviously, the destination we all hope is that she does move into employment, but the way that the systems interact, that there's no conversation to make sure that we support this woman as an individual. Instead, it's an adult support system that doesn't speak to the benefit system, is, I think, at the heart of the problem.
Okay. Hanna, did you want to come in?
No, not particularly.
I mean, when Claire mentioned children's services, and we did have evidence from that a few weeks back, and, you know, one of the things that was said by a witness, in North Ayrshire particularly, sticks in my mind because that's the area I live in. The witness said that destitution of families presenting to the local authority had increased by 500%, which is, you know, totally shocking. But it's all as a result of the welfare reform and the changes to that. You know, and how do you turn that around, and the pressure that puts on the services within that council? And also the mention was of the pressure it puts on fostering care, because, you know, the number of children being taken into care had increased hugely as well. Is that the same experience that you've had?
I think what you describe, yes, is definitely a trend. And I think what we found is that, because I think particularly single parents tell us that they are very fearful in some cases of highlighting the difficulties they face because of this fear of their children being taken into care. So I think apart from, you know, the evidence that we see on the surface, there is actually, there's been kind of research done on this in the past, where women who are parents, you know, going without food themselves so that they can feed their children. And, you know, the consequences on their health, on the parents' health, you know, being devastating. But I think definitely that when we listen to everything around what's happening to women and children, single parents, the knock-on effect is substantial in relation to services. And I think our services as well, and, you know, along with Bernardo's, what we find is we're dealing with a crisis, so many crises that the things that were actually kind of funded to deliver in relation to supporting parents, working on employability programmes. If people are coming along and they really don't have the finances to sort of feed their children properly, you're actually sort of giving them food vouchers to sort of sort that bit out first. You're putting on pizza making classes on a Saturday morning for single dads in Edinburgh because they don't have the money to feed their children when they've got a contact time with them. So it's really getting back to pretty basic kind of fundamental kind of level, really.
And this is just the tip of the iceberg, really, because as universal credit rolls out, this stringent regime is going to get worse.
Absolutely.
and affect
more people
in work as well, actually, because there's going to be conditionality, which we've not touched on, because obviously that's future, but attached to that as well. So I think the sanctions regime and the number of sanctions will increase because there'll be a requirement to work more hours or be sanctioned. So it's going in a direction of more rather than less.
I mean, one of the examples we were given in the submissions was where a mother had gone along to sign on with her, I think she had two or three children, it was the summer holidays, and she was sanctioned because the officer said, you're not available for work because you have children there. She didn't have anyone to mind her children, so she could sign on. Surely they should be addressing that as an issue, that, you know, there should be child care made available for women who are trying to seek work and they're going on these training programmes. Is there child minding available for them? Do they get vouchers, or, you know, is there any allowance made for that?
I think in relation to the case you've described, then, yeah, I mean, I think it maybe perhaps leads back to the claimant commitment. So haven't touched on that, but when someone signs on, they sign a claimant commitment. We've actually had someone sanctioned because she said she couldn't work in the evenings, and she actually applied for a job in the evening, and she actually got sanctioned because she had done something out with the claimant commitment. So it could be the case that, you know, the case that you've mentioned is that the person said one thing in their claimant commitment but done something different. And it can actually be they've behaved in a very rational way in to try and seek work, but because the claimant commitment says something different, it's like in a bureaucratic document. But as far as childcare is concerned, I think that in relation to welfare reform, what we have is a very work first, as I mentioned earlier, context, but without the infrastructure round about it to support that very work first approach. And maybe in other European countries, actually, there is an expectation that single parents go back to work at just a similarly early age, but what they do have in place is a childcare infrastructure which supports that. So it's not just about the cost of childcare, it's flexible childcare that's available, you know, at weekends or without, you know, kind of the standard hours. And you've got family-friendly employment where you've got employers that accept a child's going to be off sick, and, you know, maybe you need some time to deal with that. You know, in these other societies, you've just got support for workers as parents. You've got models which recognise that, you know, there's a combined role there, worker-parent or worker-carer. It seems to be in the UK, it's a very you know, you're a worker and there's not much taken into account with the rest of the support that's required.
I think it's worth highlighting again that there's a big difference between the legal framework and how that legal framework is applied. And there's a big difference between having sanctions as the last resort and as the first option. And that wouldn't require a change in legislation. It would require a change in policy and approach and guidance.
I would say as well, with people who are sanctioned wrongly, or they aren't told that they have a say in what's in the claimant commitment, or that they should have an opportunity to give good reason for not fulfilling one of the conditions, access to information and advice and advocacy services can be absolutely vital for these people, because when people do challenge decisions, very often the decision is overturned. And I think it's worth bringing it back again to what can be done now locally and in Scotland. And I think information to access and advice in places where women and children are likely to be could make a huge difference. We know healthier, wealthier children, for instance, where low-income families are referred through health workers to money, advice, have been very successful, perhaps through schools and through nurseries as well, because I think children's services are aware of what is happening, and it's not their role necessarily, or it's not assumed that it's their role to do something to help parents on the lowest incomes. But at the same time, when you have these huge cuts and this huge increase in destitution, but at the same time you have breakfast clubs being done away with, which is an important source of childcare. You have the cost of school transport being put up in some local authority areas, children being asked for £15 towards school trips and this kind of thing. I think it may be a small role, but there is definitely a role to play for children's services and children's services planning in terms of maximising the incomes of families that have been sanctioned, so through advocacy work and challenging sanction decisions, and minimising the outgoings of low-income families as well when they're in times of crisis, whether that's costs associated to the school day or people being asked to get a taxi to a hospital appointment and then claim that money back. But if you don't have that money in the first place, then you just can't go. So poverty-proofing services that, that low-income families are using.
Annabelle.
You know, I'll be brief. At the moment in Scotland, we've got the highest number of women ever in employment, and we've got the number of children in households with no work at all at its lowest level ever, which is encouraging in the sense that there is something positive happening. But I was very struck by what Marion Davis was saying about the pattern of childcare provision, because is it your impression that despite the very welcome improvements in the number of hours available to parents in the year, that the current pattern of provision is still too rigid?
I think it's, obviously we welcome any extensions sort of in childcare. That's all moving in the right direction. But I think the flexibility side of things is very important, and I think to have the opportunity to have childcare to meet the needs of the labour market is something that probably we need to look a lot more at. I mean, we have a programme called March and Start, and that's actually with Marks and Spencers, who have identified lone parents as a target group. And we put 320 single parents on this March and Start programme, which is tailored for single parents, their support with childcare, the hours are within the school day. But after that's finished, when they go on to work for Marks and Spencers, what they then discover is, even on a 16-hour contract, they have to be able to work half of that again. Sometimes that can be in the evening, sometimes it's on a Saturday, so the appropriate childcare to meet that need is very difficult to find. And I mean, there are services around, flexible childcare services, childcare at home, which do provide that kind of thing, and which we need more of. So if that's an answer to your question.
That's helpful. Thank you, Convener. I don't know if either of the other two want to add to that.
And I think the childcare concern that's most frequently raised, as I understand it, by the parents we work with is what Hanna touched on, which was the breakfast club and the after-school club, to allow you to drop your children off early enough at school to then go on to work and leave work and be able to pick your children up after work, which it's difficult to combine with school hours if you have no wraparound childcare support out with those school hours.
Very helpful again to us this morning. Can I thank your three witnesses for...
Is that permissible? It's a couple. It's one for Hannah McCulloch, given the evidence from the Child Poverty Action Group. I was interested in the comment about the Scottish Welfare Fund, and you wanted to see increased investment in that. I mean, have you any sense of the increase that you'd want to see?
I think it's difficult to say at the moment, and partly that is because even the money that has been made available to the Scottish Welfare Fund hasn't all been spent. I mean, so it's difficult because there seems to be an element of unmet need for the Welfare Fund isn't being recorded, partly because people aren't aware necessarily that it's there. Also, there seems to be some local authorities are only taking applications where they think there's a good chance of that application being successful, so we don't have an accurate measure of that. So it would be very difficult to put a figure on that. I think there's a need for research into that, because ideally there would be more investment and less rigid eligibility criteria, because at the moment many of the families who are affected by welfare reform wouldn't be entitled to a Scottish Welfare Fund payment anyway, particularly if they've been sanctioned.
So I can't give a straight answer to that one.
And finally, Convener, for Mr. Ballard. Did I understand you correctly, Mr. Ballard, when you were saying that the sort of changes you anticipate could be made now by DWP are matters of practice and protocol? Is that correct, particularly in relation to the sanctions regime and the application?
I think my point was that there's an urgency to getting changes, and there are some very immediate changes that we could make to, as you say, to practice and policy that would have a massive impact. I think there's a much wider question of how we have an integration between things like the GAEFEC approach, CPPs, child poverty more generally, and the social security system. But there are things that could be done quite immediately now that would help a large number of families.
Thank you very much indeed.
Yeah. So again, thank you very much to our panel for adding to the information that we've received this morning. I think we've had a couple of useful sessions, giving us a lot of information, a lot of food for thought. And as I said to the earlier group, if you have more information that becomes available to you and you want to feed it to us, please do. The more information we have, the more substantial our report will be, and hopefully we'll challenge the system in a way that you would want us to do. So the more information you give us, the better. But thank you very much for your contributions this morning. Thank you. I'll close the meeting by pointing out that our next meeting is on the 9th of June, and we expect to be meeting the Cabinet Secretary, Alec Neil, and we'll report back on the committee members' recent trips to local CAB offices and our Craig Miller Parliament Day. Okay, I'll close the meeting at that, but can I ask colleagues to hang back if they can? So that we